Sit somewhere else, sit somewhere else, sit somewhere else.
Can't sit here.
Hello friends and welcome back to Red X, your source for the freshest daily Reddit content anywhere on the internet. Promise, swearsies, it's just a fact and it's totally science. I beg of you, just please look it up, okay? Anyways, today we're jumping into r/Tales of Neckbeards. Yes, indeed, another banger from user Ramtide coming right at ya. Another Tales from the Tabletop series, I do believe it will be. And it's about his time on the road being a hobo. So that should also fit in with the filthy disgustingness that we've come to expect from most neckbeards. Anyways, I hope that you'll enjoy it. So without any further delay, let's go ahead and jump right into this thing. Drowning in pheromones on a Greyhound bus. Yep, sounds about right for a Greyhound. Ram tidings, dear friends. It is I, your dutiful lord and master, the Eternal GM. My sabbatical proved most fruitful, having figured out some of the depth mechanics for my three-dimensional combat in my pet project, Blood and Thunder, a maritime piracy RPG that has been both a joy and a nerve-wracking nightmare to create. If you want to see what's going on with that, you can swing by patreon.com/blackflagprintingpress to take a look or to support my endeavors. But I digress, because I did not come here today to talk about Blood and Thunder. No, the plug was just incidental. I came here with something else in mind, good friends. For while I have been writing my bread and butter, you have gone without your beard and butter. And this is unacceptable. And so I have trawled the depths of my memory to bring you yet another Tale from the Tabletop! Lovingly subtitled, A Prologue into Poverty. Life is not an easy thing. There was a time when life was quite difficult for me. I had far less than most, and I went without quite frequently. My entire life was loaded into a backpack filled with the bare necessities. Joys were few, and times were hard, but I made the best of it. I traveled the countryside, mostly alone, making friends where I could amongst the other forgotten souls who haunt the streets of the United States. I met a good number of people, many of them listless drifters in their own right who became fast friends. We would hang out for a time, but like all drifters, we would eventually part ways, drift apart even, called to different places to do different things. I'd just come from North Carolina. I'd been in Asheville playing bluegrass to make money with some friends who eventually proved dishonest, and so I parted ways with them. While in Asheville, I met a girl, also on the road like myself, and I developed a massive crush on her. Fortune would have it that our time together was short-lived, as she disappeared on a freighter down the train tracks, and I laid curled up in a bush, sick as a dog, for the next 3 days. Jesus. You can't get a ride from a freighter with 8 people without getting pulled off by Johnny Law. And not pulled off in the good way. Our group had fractured, and myself and one other soul continued on our own until we parted ways in Atlanta. Now on my own, clueless and green, I wandered aimlessly until a friend of mine at the time reached out to me by way of the internet. God bless the internet. He had work for me back in California if I could just make it there. What's 3,000 miles? I got this. I walked out of Atlanta, hitched a series of rides to Arkansas, and then caught a freighter myself, all the way back to the West Coast, while UP did the driving. Is that Union Pacific, I think? I laid on the back of that train for 3 days until I finally ran out of water and decided to get off. I was in Los Angeles. After a bit of panhandling, I got a bus into the Central Valley, and my friend came and scooped me up. I worked for my friend's farm for a bit, building greenhouses and stacking money, until the time came for me to once again depart. During that time, my crush from North Carolina had found me on Facebook, and we got to talking. Again, God bless the internet. She told me that she'd gone back home to Wisconsin, and was working in some greasy spoon trying to save up money to afford a bus. She'd been back for a while now, but wasn't making any headway. Her vices were getting the best of her, and she couldn't seem to get ahead. I told her that she needed to knock that shit off and try and clean up her act. After a long time talking, however, things started to get flirty and dirty. Oh yeah. I wanted to see her. And it is actually amazing what a guy will do for love. Or at least a rough approximation of love. You're how far away? Piece of cake. Hold my beer. With the work season coming to a close, I took my pay and my leave of my old friend, and he dropped me off at Modesto at the Greyhound. On the way out, he loaded me up with gifts for my travels. A new backpack, socks, a sleeping bag, some snacks for the ride, and naturally he gave me a gift that I always treasure. He gave me a set of RPG dice.
Yes.
I gave my boy a hug, wished him well in his endeavors, and promised that I'd be back in the fall to help him with the harvest and gathering some firewood. And so, I went on my merry way. I absolutely despise Greyhounds. Have you ever been on one? It's miserable. There's no room to stretch out unless you sit in the back, right by the toilet. Some asshole's always blaring garbage mumble rap on his phone all day long. It doesn't matter who you are. At the end of the trip, you exude the pungent aroma of a neckbeard. This didn't bother me too much. Personal hygiene suffers when you have no way to bathe regularly, so I was kind of used to being dirty, and my friends from the road were usually very dirty people in their own right at the time, so I could handle a certain degree of grossness within limits. I did shower at my friend's farm before I boarded that bus, though, and I was feeling rather spiffy. Clean body, clean clothes, life was good, and I was on my way to see my woman. Heck yeah, boy. I did my best to zone out. I tried to sleep as much as I could and ignore the general atmosphere of the bus, but that was no longer an option after a layover in Las Vegas. We boarded the bus once more after an almost 24-hour delay on our schedules and finally got moving again. I sat in the back near the toilet, as I was no stranger to this game and I wanted that bench seat. And foul smells at the time, as I said, didn't bother me much. Or so I thought. With the bus filling up and the seats reduced to the slimmest pickings, it dawned on me that my coveted backseat bench was going to get shared. Then I saw him. The bus beard. Oh no. I'm usually a pretty nice person, but I did not want my coveted backseat bench seat getting taken up, let alone by this massive lard ass that now lumbered towards me. I did everything in my power to seem as big and hostile as I could. This was all in vain, however, as some people just cannot read social cues, neckbeards being chief among them. I stared at him, dripping hostility, mentally repeating, "Sit somewhere else, sit somewhere else, sit somewhere else," like it was a Zen mantra. However, nobody wanted him to sit by them either, and so he made his way closer and closer as he asked people if seats were taken, until he got to me at the back. He shifted to sit into the seat, angling his ass in the general direction of my face. The smell of soggy, feces-laden underwear, Jesus Christ, wafted up as he slid his bulk onto the bench. Did I mention that personal hygiene suffers on a Greyhound bus ride, especially when you've been riding for days? I've taken my fair share of Greyhounds, and it's unlikely that this new arrival had been riding for a while. He was eastbound, like the rest of us, and we were only in Las Vegas, so his point of origin could not have been very far west. I had only been on the bus for approximately a day or so, minus the extended layover time, of course, so I was getting a little sweaty myself. But this guy smelled as if he not only lived on this bus, but was born in the blue poop goop of the latrine. Poop goop. It was a worthy question of debate as to whether this man had actually employed the use of a speed stick in his life. His patchy jowls jiggled at me as he said, "Hi." "Hello." And indeed, Ramtide responded with a gruff and monotone, "Hello." And then turned his attention to the window, watching the bus depot workers loading up the suitcases beneath. My fate was sealed. This man was to be my travel companion all the way to Denver. I decided then that maybe it would be best to just ignore him. I plugged in my phone, booted up an emulator that I'd downloaded, and started to play some Pokemon to whittle away the hours. It didn't take long, however, before I could feel his olfactory looming becoming physical looming as he examined the screen upon which I played from over my shoulder. Aw, Ram, video games ain't the way to ward off a neckbeard. You gotta pull out a book. Busbeard.
Pokemon! I fucking love Pokemon! I didn't know you could play it on a phone. How are you doing that?
His heavy respirations were like an infusion of green spearmint and halitosis. OP, emulators. I went back to my game, trying to angle myself away from him in such a way that he couldn't lean over my shoulder and watch me as I trained my team, but I was effectively sandwiched between him and the wall, forced to sit straight as he leaned over and watched me play. I debated then what I ought to do. Playing Pokemon would make the time fly, but I would be crushed between the window and a sweaty fat man. Not playing Pokemon would save me the physical agony of being squished, but I would be painfully bored for seemingly endless miles, and he may use that as an opportunity to interact further. A decision needed to be made. I shut the emulator off and put away my phone, turning my attention back out the window as the bus pulled out of the Las Vegas terminal and began down the freeway. It was not long after we had pulled out of the station, however, when that wheezing, rasping voice chirped up again. Busbeard.
So, where are you going?
I ignored him, focusing on the casinos towering in the distance of the skyline, pretending as if I hadn't heard the question or as if it wasn't addressed to me. With insistence, he repeated his question at my turned back, searching for a response within my stony exterior. I mumbled, "The Midwest," and he questioningly grunted and asked me
to repeat myself.
I guess we're doing this. OP, I'm going to the Midwest. Busbeard,
where in the Midwest?
OP, Wisconsin. Busbeard,
I never been to Wisconsin before, but I know they got really good cheese. Is that why you're going there?
Judging by his smell, he must have been an excessively avid connoisseur of fine Wisconsinite cheese. However, cheese was the last thing on my mind at the time, unless we talking dick cheese. Because I was enamored with my lady love. OP, I'm going to see an old friend. Busbeard.
Oh, that's cool. Who is it?
You don't know her, dude. The odds of this man knowing the person who I was on my way to visit were astronomically low. Your odds of getting struck by lightning, winning the lottery, and becoming president all in the same day were probably higher than this cretin knowing the one specific person whom I was going to visit in some backwater Wisconsin town. Still, I humored him, and in the same flat voice I answered his question, and I told him that I was on my way to see my sweetheart. This caught Busbeard's attention. For a grown man in his mid-30s, he let out a loud, "Ooh!" like a middle schooler would when he finds out his friends has a crush, or like a beluga whale. I contemplated the execution methods and the subjective severity of their barbarism as he excitedly asked me
where she was from.
OP, Wisconsin. Busbeard.
Yeah, but where in Wisconsin?
OP, fuck off, dude. I'm not gonna tell you the town where she lives. Busbeard.
I'd be terrified of telling a superior male like me where my girlfriend lives too. A little kid like you wouldn't stand a chance next to a man like me. Her panties would hit the floor from one whiff of my pheromones.
Yeah, he's quite pungent.
It happens all the time, bro. I swear, I could have any woman on this bus. They just can't resist me. They could just sense my manhood. I know it.
I shouldn't stir the pot. All common sense tells me that I should just stop myself while I'm ahead, but sometimes, I just can't help myself. I've always been a pretty reserved and self-contained person, for the most part, and I just want to be left alone 90% of the time to do my thing. Apparently, that's a lot to ask, because every now and then, somebody comes and invades my personal space with their protruding belly, bad breath, and general self-aggrandizement. And then, I find it really hard to resist my inborn inclination to fuck with them. I know. It's wrong of me to do that, but I'm human, damn it. And something good was a-cooking in the kitchen. What's the harm of dipping a spoon into this self-important concoction of body odor and bravado? Don't put that in your mouth. OP? Any woman, huh? I'll tell you what, Buzzbeard. I just got paid, and you seem really confident in the power of your, pheromones. So, how about a wager? I laid out the terms of my devil's bargain. With a wager of $100, I would pick a lady on the bus at the next break. Busbeard would then have to seduce her. Oh, that poor woman. He must present his pheromones to her naturally. And if he recovered her phone number or anything in excess thereof, like a kiss or a consensual toilet stall consummation, it would suffice to meet my criteria and loose my grasp from the freshly printed Franklin in my wallet. He agreed enthusiastically to my terms, insisting that
I was gonna lose and he was gonna get his dick sucked in a Greyhound Porter John, Blumpkin style.
God. I haven't heard Blumpkin since like 7th grade or something. People don't do that, do they? We rode along in silence for the next hour or so. The sun was high in the sky when we made our next stop at some gas station in Utah, and everyone filed off the bus to stretch their legs and get their snacks. I wandered around, huffing down my smoke, chatting it up with people and making friends, seeing just who they were, asking them questions, where they were going, who they were going there with, and I got to talking with one guy and his girlfriend. The guy, who we'll call Sarge, was built like a brick shithouse, and was a former infantryman who served 2 tours of duty in the Middle East. He was traveling with his wife, a young and pretty little thing who we will call Alexandra. They were on their way back to the East Coast to stay with family. Alexandra's mom was getting old, and had asked them to move in and help take care of her. They were on their way out there to steward her aging mother's estate. I remarked that that was awfully kind of them, and sincerely wished them the best on taking care of Alexandra's aging mom. I then told them a bit about myself as well, that I was effectively living on the road, playing life by ear, and on the way to see a loved one of mine for a bit before the wind blew me somewhere else. Eventually, the bus driver gave everyone a 5-minute warning before departure, and we all filed back on board. I moved back to my seat and waited for Busbeard to arrive. He came back, cradling piles of gas station sandwiches, bags of chips, and a couple of sodas in his massive paws. He sat down beside me with a loud, "Oof!" and offered me a drink, saying,
"It's the least he could do before he took my money."
I took that beverage. It was both cold and delicious. OP, "Well, Busbeard, I done my rounds and I've come to a decision." Busbeard,
"Who is it? She better be hot. I swear to God, dude, if you make me waste my time on some dried up roasty, I'm gonna be so fucking pissed at you, dude."
OP, "Why would I do that, dude? Naturally, I only want the best for you." "No, she's very pretty. You see that girl over there in the aisle seat? That's the one. Make your move whenever you're ready." I pointed out Alexandra to him, and I already knew that this was going to end very poorly. There was no way in hell that Alexandra would express any interest in this disgusting lard-ass whatsoever when she had a stable and solid man like Sarge, and Sarge wasn't about to take guff from anyone. Add on to that that Sarge was easily the size of, if not bigger than, the prodigious Busbeard himself. Sarge was also trained to kill, and hardened by years of combat in the graveyard of empires. I can fight. I fought a lot. And I would not want to square up against him in any circumstances. Busbeard was going to get the snot beat out of him and pay me $100 for that privilege. Oh, juicy. The bus took off, and I listened to the disgusting sounds of Busbeard inhaling the equivalent of 5 pounds of gas station food.
Yummy.
I was only halfway through my soda when Busbeard emitted a satisfied belch that rumbled the seats, and the feeding frenzy had ended in an effervescence of curdling bile and preservatives just as fast as it had begun. God, Riptide's writing style is just the best, isn't it? He then started to pump himself up, for the task at hand. He started to sweat with excitement and latent cardiac arrest as he prepared his pheromonal aura about himself. And then with a gruff,
"All right, let's do this,"
he stood up from his seat and waddled down the aisle, his greasy belly bumping into everyone who had chosen an aisle seat. He approached Alexandra. They were near the front end of the bus, and so I couldn't hear a word that they were saying. I watched Busbeard as he extended an arm and held on to the overhead luggage rack, exposing the damp miasma of corn syrup infested armpit sweat to his unsuspecting victim. His pheromones were beginning to work their magic over unsuspecting Alexandra, who would soon be enraptured by its juicy spell. I waited, leaning forward intently, when a loud shout broke the silence. "Sarge, back the fuck up!" Alexander started to shout too, yelling,
"Ew, get the fuck away from me!"
The driver turned back and yelled for everyone to sit down and shut the hell up, or he would pull the bus over. "Sarge, please do! I'ma beat this fucking lard ass into the pavement! Saying shit like that to my wife? Who the fuck do you think you are?" The bus driver repeated his warning, and Busbeard began to shout his protests, insisting upon his innocence. Busbeard,
"But I was put up to it. It was that guy in the back seat. He said..."
He pointed back at me. I yelled back, "I don't know that fucking guy." It's the perfect response. The bus driver meant his threat and actually did pull the bus over. We were on a long and empty stretch of the I-15 somewhere in rural Utah. The last town I had seen was about 20 miles back. It was late spring and it was getting hot outside that afternoon. The bus driver got out of his seat, walked up to Busbeard, and told him to get the hell off of his bus. Busbeard kept protesting when Sarge moved past his wife and started forcing Busbeard toward the front door. See, because pheromones are a threat. Fellow alpha males don't like that. You have too many pheromones. I've heard the threat of getting kicked off maybe 1,000 times on a Greyhound, but I had never seen it play out before. Busbeard was thrown off the bus. Sarge did not join him outside and pummel him into the asphalt, regrettably, as much as I would have loved to watch that. Busbeard kept pleading with the bus driver as the driver shut the door on him, sealing him out on the shoulder of a lonely stretch of highway. Jesus Christ. I breathed a sigh of relief and stretched out my legs. Yeah, boy. It was another 15 miles before we saw any signs of civilization. A part of me felt bad for Busbeard, but the other part of me said, if I can walk 20 miles in a day with 60 pounds of shit on my back, he can do an unencumbered 15 and be fine. He probably will be fine, but he's gonna remember that shit forever. The ride continued on in sweet, reclined silence for me until we reached Denver, wherein there was another changeover, and this bus was much, much more desolate. Ah. The rest of the Greyhound voyage passed without incident, and I spent my time flirting with my lady love and training some Pokemons. At long last, I finally arrived in Wisconsin. She came to pick me up at the bus station, and when we approached each other, we made out like long-lost lovers for a good 5 minutes before we finally caught our breath enough to say hello. I got in her car and spent maybe a week or so with her before it was time to take my leave. I couldn't live there forever, and so, as fast as I had drifted into her life, once again, it was time for me to disappear. We said goodbye, and she dropped me off at a lonely interstate overpass at the edge of town. I put my thumb out to catch a ride to anywhere but here, USA. I planned my next move, and I figured there were some friends of hers and mine that lived not too far away in the Dakotas, and maybe I'd pay them a visit next. I was in the neighborhood, and I figured that I might as well say hello. I reached out to them online and made my way west again. They were excited for me to come and see them. It was only a day into the voyage when I received a message from Janet. It said, "Wait for me, I'm catching up." She'd packed her backpack again and was coming after me, hot on my tail. I told her that we could meet up at our mutual friend's house. I dialed ahead to our friends, who we shall call Sarah and Queenie. Sarah used to travel together with Janet for many months before she stabilized and then settled down. Queenie was one of my friends from North Carolina. He was a lovable chuckle fuck of a drifter, missing a few teeth, wore a skirt, and spoke in the most haggard voice you could imagine. Still, he insisted on being called Queenie. He'd settled down with Sarah after they had hooked up, and they were living at Sarah's house. He was on thin ice there, however, and she was threatening to kick him out. I arrived at Sarah and Queenie's and spent the next few days waiting for Janet to come up on my heels. During that time, Queenie and I played a lot of magic. He'd just gotten into it. And I remembered the dice that my friend in California had given me that were just laying unused in my backpack. I asked him if he had ever played tabletop RPGs before, to which he answered, no. And I told him that maybe next time I see him, and I'm in a better spot, we could run a game. Eventually Janet caught up, and we prepared to leave Sarah's for good towards our new horizons. Queenie, however, had finally broken through that thin ice upon which he skated, and was getting thrown out. Upon the day of our departure, we asked him if he wanted to join us in our travels so he wouldn't have to go it alone. Thus, we began from Sarah's house, out into the unknown once again. A cheerful trio, and true to my word, I began to teach not only Queenie, but Janet as well, the joys of tabletop RPGs. As I'm sure you can surmise, dear friends, this is not the end of our story, but only the beginning of yet another chapter. Is Busbeard still alive? What does the future hold for Ramtide's love life? How do a gaggle of vagabond drifters play tabletop games without a table? Asking the big questions. Some of these questions will indeed be answered, my dear friends, in our next installment of Tales from the Tabletop! Well, I've known Ramtide for a long time, you guys, and as guys tend to do, we don't talk about much outside of what is going on at this moment, so I haven't heard a lot of these stories, and I'm super excited to see where it goes. I might remember Janet a little bit from something that he mentioned, but if it's the same girl that I'm thinking of, then the ending is sure to be explosive. As for Busbeard, man, that is just classic. I would have liked for him to get his ass kicked too, probably honestly. It's what guys like that need before they fucking learn how to mellow out. But we live in a society, and society says that you can't just pummel people into the asphalt, even if their mouth is writing checks that their ass can't cash. Well, I'll tell you, Busbeard is gonna have less of an ass once he finishes his 15-mile walk into town. Boy, truly nothing but what he deserves. Honestly, I would have been sad about not getting paid the $100, but isn't a life lesson worth so much more? As always, fantastically fucking pristine, the best writing style from Ramtide. And I'm super glad that he's on my team. I definitely appreciate the stories, my dude. I'm glad your sabbatical was not too long because honestly, I don't know what I'd do without you. I don't know what my listeners would do without you. There are tales out there, but there is nothing that is written quite like Ramtide stuff. So, definitely a bro for life. I'm on the edge of my seat waiting for more Queenie and what's-her-face, Janet. And of course, the well-behaved, self-aware neckbeard himself, Mr. Ramtide. And all of the adventures and shenanigans that await us. I hope that you'll show your appreciation, friends, by liking, commenting, and or subscribing on this video, maybe sharing it around because it is apparently part one of a new saga that's going to unfold, so now is a great time to drag people in, and maybe show them the previous Ramtide sagas if you're up for that. We've also got links in the description, not all of those were shown on the splash page. I also included Ramtide's Patreon if you guys would like to support him there. And of course, you're seeing some names on the screen, and those would be my very own gorgeous, wonderful, beautiful, generous patrons. And I would like to thank them all, but specifically, Lady Nyx, Robert Waits, Pope Squid, Rebecca H, Cider Drinker, Tato Ferret, The Last Shinobi, Michael Undead, Aaron W, Mitch, John Hero, Josh K, and Candy Sora. Thank you guys so much for helping me to live the dream. I cannot express how much I appreciate it. If anybody else wants to donate monetarily, that is massively appreciated as well. But if you don't have the means at the moment, then don't sweat it too hard. I definitely just appreciate you hanging out with me today, and I hope that you'll come back and hang out with me tomorrow. In order to do so, you will need to take care of yourselves out there, keep yourselves safe, and that means washing your hands, like a lot, like anytime. It's never a bad idea to wash your hands. I also want you to take some time out and do something that you enjoy today. Something just for yourself. Something similar to watching Red X videos. Maybe even watching another Red X video. That would be cool. Because always remember that you are loved, you are worthy, and you definitely, definitely deserve it. I'll see you guys in the next one. And until then, bye-bye.